My job is, as the medical oncologist, is to get you a little bit on both PRRT and some of the other therapies that we have going on in neuroendocrine tumors. And the one thing you'll see from the medical oncologists, from Thor and myself, is we have a saying that, you know, in God we trust, but everybody else requires data. So you'll see some of that data. And for the surgeons out there, that God is not synonymous with you. but we have to remind them of that sometimes. So as we look at somatostatin and we look at octreotide, as Dr. Oricio pointed out, it was originally approved because it improved carcinoid syndrome. But there was a debate going on whether it actually had anti-cancer activity, right? Did it have anti-proliferative activity? So one of the first trials that we saw where we had some clue of this was the PROMID trial that took patients, again, who were having progressive cancers, mid-gut neuroendocrine tumors, and randomized them to octreotide or placebo. And the bottom line, which is this sort of yellow group here, is that we showed that, indeed, octreotide seemed to slow tumor growth, right? So at least, you know, I think many people would say, of course, we knew that. I think many of us believe that to be the case. But this is sort of one of the first trials where we really had that indication. Then another trial was done, as you heard about lanreotide. This is the Clarinet trial. Again, this is for all gastroenteropancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. Now, this group of patients did not have progressive disease. So when I point to my fellows, there's a couple of interesting things about this trial. One, there's no question that lanreotide does better than, you know, sort of a sugar-esque vehicle in terms of people doing well without their tumors growing. But if you take a look at the placebo group, and again, this is a group of patients with these tumors that were not growing, and you take a look at kind of what we call the median, the halfway point here, you still see that people were getting nothing, right? Just essentially pure observation. We are still sitting at 18 months where they had a tumor that was not growing. So when we counsel patients, you know, you may not have to do anything right now. And that's, you know, very frequently one of the first things I say is, yes, you've got this tumor. Yes, it's a cancer, but it's not like any other cancer you've ever heard of, and we may not actually need to treat you right away. It's based on sort of data like this that we make those determinations. We are fortunate, again, to have, you know, many other therapies. So for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, we have drugs like everolimus, and this is a mTOR inhibitor, where, again, we see that we get almost a year on this drug before tumors seem to grow. Very similar results with a drug called sunitinib, or Sutent, and this is a drug that works after the blood vessel growth of tumors. I should put here the chemotherapy combination that you've heard about, the capecitabine and temozolomide. We saw actually some very exciting data this year in Chicago at our meeting, a trial called the ECOG 2211 trial that looked at patients who got temozolomide or the combination of capecitabine and temozolomide, and the number here in terms of progression-free survival was around 22 to 23 months, as well as response rates at about 30%. Because the one thing about these drugs is they don't get us tumor shrinkage very much, right? And that's the same thing with octreotide, lanreotide. We don't see tumor shrink, but we do see stabilization, whereas with the chemotherapy, we see tumor shrinkage in about 30% of the cases, and we're seeing, you know, very long, close to 2 years, where tumors aren't growing on that. And similarly, we have evidence within the other neuroendocrine tumors of benefits of the mTOR inhibitor everolimus. So we do have a wonderful group of therapies, and again, one of the things that you've heard from today is we're all trying to figure out how do we now sequence and combine all of these therapies together, and that requires a multidisciplinary group of individuals getting together and talking. That's why, you know, if you learn nothing from today, the most important thing to understand is that any cancer diagnosis, certainly neuroendocrine is one of those, is almost never a medical emergency, right? There are exceptions, but cancer diagnosis is almost never an emergency. It's an urgency, but it's not an emergency, and you have time to get to the right place, to the right center, to the right group of people looking at things. And, you know, as you see all this information, all the things that we have to think about, how important it is that we can talk to each other, do tumor boards, if we have to call our colleagues across the country, do those type of things to make sure that we put a plan in place for you that makes the most sense. So what is peptide receptor radionuclide therapy? Very, very clever biochemistry and molecular biology. taking again, essentially the octreotide moiety and putting with a chelator and then putting a radioactive particle, whether that be lutetium, which is the Lutathera that you hear about in the NETRF trial, or as you heard with the Odoricios, an yttrium moiety. But again, what's available in the United States right now and has been approved is lutetium sort of moiety attached to this. And, again, how do we believe it works? Well, again, it gets into the bloodstream, it binds to these SSTR2 receptors, gets brought into the cell, and essentially you're giving it a sort of Trojan horse payload. They bring it in, and you get death of the tumor cells. And again, hopefully not too much damage to surrounding cells that don't have the receptors on them. So this, of course, was the trial that for the United States finally got the FDA to listen to what the Europeans had been telling us really for the last 15 to 20 years is this stuff works. And so this was a trial that randomized, about 230 or so patients to either, these are again all patients who had well-differentiated mid-gut neuroendocrine tumors. It was done in this population having to do with, we actually had more treatments in pancreatic neuroendocrine, so you always had to figure out what your sort of control arm is going to be. So we chose the mid-gut neuroendocrine tumors, again with Ki-67 markers of less than 20%. They either got a higher dose of octreotide, so almost all these patients were on 30 milligrams of octreotide and tumors had progressed, so you either got double the dose of octreotide or you got the lutetium compound and you continued your octreotide. So again, the rules were you had to have progressive disease in the last 3 years. You had to have some evidence, and in this case, NETSPOT was not yet available. So most of these patients had octrea scans, and then you had to have adequate organ function. So in here, it was the kidneys were working, so something we look at, which called creatinine clearance, and of course, we wanted to make sure that bone marrow was in a good enough shape to receive the therapy. This is how it's given. So again, you get it once every 2 months for 4 treatments. We typically, again, hold the sandostatin shots for about a month before you get it, and then we typically give it again. And in the trial, it was given about 24 hours after lutetium was given. And then we give an amino acid infusion while you're getting the therapy. Let's go back here. So again, we give drugs for anti-nausea. This mainly has to do because of the amino acids, and the amino acids are being given to protect the kidneys. Dr. Oricio and their group at Iowa actually have a much nicer combination of amino acids that don't cause as much nausea. Many of us are working on getting those things compounded at our centers. It's like an act of Congress to get a compounding. More than I ever realized, but we'll all get there. In the meantime, it's very important, at least if you're getting what was standardly used in the trial, the two main amino acids, that you get a very good anti-nausea regimen. We give a drug called the MEN, which is a kinase 1 inhibitor. We give drugs like Decadron, and then I tend to send patients home for 3 days on a drug called Zyprexa or olanzapine for 3 days, and again, Decadron for 3 days at home, which does a pretty good job of knocking out the nausea and vomiting. So why are we so excited, about this? So these are curves that you've seen a lot of, and for those who don't live in our world, you may not be familiar, but these are called Kaplan-Meier curves. And essentially what they do is they say, we want to really look at the time, every time a patient's tumor grows, they sort of have a little downtick in the curve, and we want to compare how long it takes, for patients' tumors to grow on lutetium versus how long it took them to grow when they were on the higher octreotide dosing. And what you see here is very, very impressive results, with this being the lutetium arm doing much better from what we call progression-free for survival standpoint. So looking at tumor growth or patients who died from their tumors, and in fact did not even hit the 50% mark. So again, greater than 50% of the patients were still alive. And again, on the overall survival, it was still a little bit early, so we need enough cases, and fortunately, people do well enough with this tumor that we haven't seen enough cases yet to definitively say an overall survival, but certainly we like the direction this is going and an improvement in survival. So these are the kind of definitive data we like to see in a true randomized trial that give us confidence that this stuff really works. And so, that's the thoughts there. as I explained, it's not like we were the first people in the United States to figure this out. The Europeans have been doing this for many years, so we do have wonderful data. This is data coming from the Dutch, you know, showing that not only does it work what we know in the midgut cancers, but we're seeing it in pancreas cancer, in bronchus, in unknown primaries. So we really seem to have a robust response across different tumors. Again, these aren't randomized data, but at least they're showing us that not just what we studied in NETTER, but really across the board, we really seem to see you know, sort of advantage here. In terms of response rates, you know, as we looked at the data, we see about 20, probably going up to about 30% tumor shrinkage, not too dissimilar to, from what we see with, you know, capecitabine and temozolomide, certainly much better than we see with sunitinib or everolimus or octreotide or lanreotide therapy. Side effect wise, so again, the nausea is the big thing that jumps out at everybody, but that's the amino acid. That's not really the lutetium doing that. Same thing, obviously, with vomiting. The bone marrow side effects and the fatigue are ones that we worry the most about. But this is these are data that are going to be just published ahead of print and will soon be published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology. One of the wonderful things they did in this trial is they did very detailed looks at patients' quality of life. So we look at quality of life through several surveys that we give patients, and we not only look at overall quality of life, but we look at it in several different domains, right? Everywhere from how you're doing physically to how people view their body image to diarrhea, et cetera. And pretty much every way we looked at it, patients' quality of life was much better on the lutetium, so the Lutathera, than it was on the 60 milligrams of octreotide. So again, you know, from our standpoint, we obviously want therapies that work, that prolong survival, that get people living longer, but we don't want to do that at the expense of your quality of life. And the fact that we're seeing not only improvement, you know, in our disease-free survival endpoints, but seeing improvement in patients' quality of life is really, really heartening, you know, to those of us who do this for a living. And again, congratulations to the people who ran the trial and the patients who suffered from doing all the surveys. You know, for those of you who've been in clinical trials, we know we put you through a lot, but we do it so that we can have this kind of information, again, to help the next, you know, wave and generation of patients. So, again, it has been approved, and it is an injection that we're going to give essentially once every other month for 4 treatments. The big things about it is most of the lutetium is cleared from the plasma very quickly. And again, it depends how much tumor you have. Obviously, the bigger amount of tumor, the more stays in the tumor, and so it takes a little bit longer for it to get cleared from the body. The rest is cleared through the urine, and then it can take a few days for it really to get out of the system. So here are the things from the company standpoint that they recommend for patients, which is, so we always have patients, you know, we have them urinate while they're there in a separate bedpan. We close off a bathroom for them, again, to make sure nobody else gets exposed. Then we ask them to sleep in a separate bed, you know, for 2 to 3 days. If you need longer or would like longer, I'm sure your doctor can write you an order for that. For infants and children, again, since, you know, we obviously don't, you know, we worry about the effects, be a little more susceptible, we recommend 7 days instead of, you know, sleeping in a separate bedroom. Pregnant patients, the recommendation, you know, is to sleep in a separate bedroom for about 2 weeks. Return to work about 2 to 3 days, you know, after. You know, and again, you know, trying to avoid public places, et cetera. I mean, these are probably a little bit on the overkill side, but you know, the point is, there is some radioactivity that still persists even after you leave the clinic. Most of it is gone by the time you leave the clinic. So I've told you all the wonderful things. Is there any bad side to this? Well, the big one that we worry about is bone marrow. Because a couple things. We've learned from many of our different cancers that if I go and do a bone marrow biopsy on someone with prostate cancer, and probably the same is true for neuroendocrine tumor, I may very well find some neuroendocrine tumor cells in your bone marrow. We don't go looking for it, but it's likely that some of those cells are there. So when I give a drug that is releasing radiation therapy, radiation and the bone marrow don't get along very well. And what we have seen through the European data, don't quite have enough follow-up with a NETTER trial yet to know this for sure, but the number we're quoting, folks, is about a 2%, maybe up to a 3% risk of something called myelodysplastic syndrome, which is essentially a pre-leukemia state or, you know, outright leukemia. So obviously this is something that worries us. that we have to take into account before we all get excited and give everyone this therapy. If we've talked about sequencing of therapies, we have to be careful. Some of our drugs like temozolomide also have bone marrow toxicity. We don't know ultimately how drugs like temozolomide and things like lutetium are going to play out together. So these are things, again, we have to be aware of, we have to watch out for, and you know, you all, you know, should know about. So with that, in my 10 minutes, I hope I've given you at least some sense of why we're so excited about PRRT therapy. And but you also see that we have a lot of things in our armamentarium now that we didn't have 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And it now becomes the job of all the researchers here that, you've heard and many others to figure out, how do we put this all together? How do we sequence it? And ultimately, how do we personalize it for each and every one of you so that, you know, we're giving the right drug to the right patient at the right time? And those are the type of things that we will continue to, you know, work on and try to figure out. And so I think now you're going to hear a little bit more on some of the practical aspects of getting PRRT therapy and what it means for you. And I think we're going to have a panel discussion then at the end of that, where we'll be taking questions and doing some case studies. So with that, I thank you very much for your time.